This part of the course is about linear regression. Linear regression is a powerful method for testing and quantifying an association between two continuous variables. We'll think about the example throughout where we have two continuous variables, one of them blood pressure and the other an obesity score. When we analyze this relationship using linear regression, we do two things. We decide that there's a direction of the association, that one variable x has an impact on the other variable. So we quantify if x changes, how much would we expect y to change. Second thing we do is then we formulate this linear relationship that y and x, the relationship can be depicted using a straight line. So y is called the response variable or outcome variable or dependent variable, and x is called an explanatory variable or an independent variable. Often x is also called a covariate. So we use bivariate observations for n individuals and we do the analysis. And in the example of obesity score and blood pressure, we will assume that x is the obesity score and y is the blood pressure, so we quantify how much differences in obesity score is expected to cause differences in blood pressure. Another example we'll also look at is measurements of blood fat, and I will show you both data sets now. I have printed the blood pressure data set and it looks like this. So we also have information about gender, but we look at the relationship between the obesity score and the blood pressure for 102 subjects. The blood fat data set looks like this. I think I don't need the observation number here. I have a measurement of cholesterol and I have a measurement of triglycerides. And both of these are concentrations in the blood. We will discuss scatter plots, residual plots, histograms, probability plots, and at the very end we'll talk a little bit about correlation. So if I look at the data set, I can see it looks like this. I use this option that only prints the first 7 observations. And if I want to look at a scatter plot, I can use this and I can see that the obesity score here on the x-axis seems to have some sort of association with the blood pressure on the y-axis. I can add something to my SG plot. I can change the size and color of the markers. I can change the labels and now I get output that looks like this. Notice that I also add grid lines. Let me copy this and jump back to and let us see what it looks like for the other data set. If I use PROC SGPlot, I can use it not only for the blood pressure data set, but I can also use it for the blood fat data set. Then I have to choose one continuous variable as the Y variable and the other as the X variable. I choose just this at random, and maybe this is not reasonable and we will have to change this around later on. I run this SAS program and I can see it looks like this. Here there also seems to be some sort of relationship that I put the labels, and of course this is incorrect. The x-axis is cholesterol and the y-axis is this triglycerin. So I need to change this around, it looks like this. But we see the association that when the x variable increases, there's a tendency that the y variable also increases. So linear regression makes the assumption that there is this linear association. So we use this mathematical formula that describes a straight line. The variable beta zero is the intersection over here, and it's the expected value of y for somebody who has a value, an x value of zero. So in the BP data set, this would be the expected blood pressure for somebody with an obesity score of zero. If I look up here at this, I see that in my data set I have nobody with an obesity score even close to zero, so that's probably an unreasonable extrapolation. If I look at my data set here, I also have nobody with a value of zero, so that's also probably an unreasonable extrapolation. But if we want to fit a straight line here, we have to specify where it starts. So we need the beta zero, even if it doesn't have a nice interpretation. The beta one has a very nice interpretation, because that's the slope of the line, and this means that when the x variable increases one unit, this is how many units the y variable increases. So if I go up here and put in a line, the beta 1 would be the expected change in blood pressure when the obesity score increases one unit. If I go back here, the beta 1 would be the expected change in triglyceride when the cholesterol concentration increases one unit. Oh, of course, these data and the data up here, they are not on a straight line, so there's some random variation, and we add this random variation by taking the line from before and then adding random errors. These are depicted, described by the Greek letter epsilon, and are called residuals or error terms. Then it turns out that you can use this, and then you can estimate the parameters beta 0 and beta 1 by minimizing the epsilons. So whenever I come up with a guess of beta 1 and beta 0, I can calculate how far away from the line that the beta 1 and beta 0 I've chosen generates my points are. I can square all the differences, and that's the squared epsilons, and then I can choose beta 0 and beta 1 to make this one as small as possible, and this is called the method of least squares. This method is very simple, has been known for a long time. You can do it using pencil and paper, and it has been known since the, I think, early 19th century. So when I do this, I can then estimate beta 0 and beta 1, and this would be very interesting. I could say, well, I can get a beta 1 here that tells me what the association is. I can get a beta 1 up here that tells me what the association is. But when I do all of this, I make a number of implicit assumptions. And it's very important, before I estimate my parameters and look at it, that I wonder about these implicit assumptions. So I assume linearity in the mean value, that's the most important assumption, and if that assumption is wrong, then I cannot trust the results. I assume that the residuals are independent of each other, I assume that the residuals have a normal distribution, and I assume that there's just a single variance here, it's the same variance for all the epsilons. So the assumption of linearity is the most important one, and I start out by adding something to the scatter plot. So I can use my scatter plot here, and then instead of using the statement scatter, I can use a LOES statement. LOES stands for locally estimated scatter plot smoothing. I put it in, and this is the best fitting smooth curve. It actually looks as if the best fitting smooth curve is not far away from a straight line. So this gives me an idea about. Maybe the linear association isn't a terrible idea to model this. Of course, I can also add a regression line, then I specify reg instead, and I get this straight line. In SAS, I can look at this plot and I can say, well, actually, in here, let me specify that I want a straight line, a regression line instead. Let me put it in like this and see what it looks like. It looks as if there is a straight line going through these points. Two things to notice about this. Whenever I see a straight line like this, I immediately think that the straight line is correct just because I'm looking at the straight line. Another point to notice is there's one very single observation out here that seems to be far away from all the others. It could be wrong, or it could just be an outlier for other reasons, and it's sort of maybe this pulls in the line, maybe this pulls the line a lot. So it would be interesting here to say, well, if what if this one wasn't in the data set, would we get the same line? Of course, an idea would be to add both the straight line and the lowest locally estimated scatter plot smoothing in the same plot. Can we do this? Yes, we can. It looks like this, and here I see that the straight line looks like this and the locally estimated smoothing looks like this. And here I see that maybe in here, where I have a lot of data, the linear association, maybe it's not a perfect, maybe it's not the perfect description here. So I need to think about whether the model fits, and of course there are other assumptions as well. We looked at linearity, but we also need to look at whether the error terms are normally distributed and whether it's reasonable to assume that the variance is the same for all epsilons. Now I will go ahead and fit the linear regression model, and this is because in order to test the model I need these epsilons, so I need to estimate the model, I need to estimate the parameters beta 0 and beta 1 in order to get the epsilon, in order to test if the model fits. So I do this and I go down here and I use the procedure called progreg. This gives me several parts of the output, and here I just choose two parts, the part called analysis of variance, it's kind of a strange name, and the part called parameter estimates. The output then looks like this, and here in my parameter estimates I have beta 0 and I have beta 1. So the estimated relation is whenever there's a 1 unit difference in obesity score, there is a 23 unit difference in blood pressure. I can get confidence intervals using the option CLB, and here I select only the parameter estimates using either of these two ways of specifying it. For my blood fat dataset, I can also do this, and here I have triglyceride on the y-axis and cholesterol on the x-axis, so I need to specify it like this. Then I choose that I want the parameter estimates and this part of the output called analysis of variance, and I submit this. And here I get the parameter estimates whenever cholesterol increases 1 unit, triglyceride increases 0.59 units. This is significant, and if I want a confidence interval, I go back here and I specify CLB, confidence limits for beta. Notice here that up here it says progreg running. This is because it's an old procedure, and in the old days it was useful to keep some stuff in the memory of the computer in case I wanted to do a new analysis. This is not useful anymore, but it keeps on running, keeps this stuff until I also write quit. So now I run it again, specifying quit, and I add the option CLB. Then I get the confidence limit, and I can see that this 0.59 is really an estimate that could be anywhere in this confidence interval. So what about the variance around the regression line? Well, it's estimated like this. Once I have my estimates of intercept and slope, I just plug it in and get the variance. And then I have something called mean square error. The value in the BP dataset is 298. You can see where it's located here on the mean square and error. And what is the variance in the blood fat dataset? Well, it's here on the mean square and error, and this is a very big number. Of course, these are variances and they are difficult to interpret, so if you take the square root of them, if I take the square root of this number, I get something that is also on the same scale as the dependent variable, so this I get something that is on the triglyceride concentration scale, and it's probably more useful to make this transformation. There's no way to get this out of progreg, so you have to do it by hand, copying this and getting it on a calculator or using some other way of doing it. For the BP dataset, I take the square root of this number and I get a value of 17.3, and this 17.3 is easy to interpret because this is simply on the blood pressure scale. Before we go on and trust these results, we need to do model control.